we really need to get your mind set and programmed that if you can't see yourself clearly ripped on stage, if you're not seeing that, those images of you on stage ripped at this right now, 6 weeks out, that is the most important thing, because everything else will fall into place, Ben. When I do a high volume training session, if I'm not having any carbs, man, the next day I am noticeably leaner. I'm visibly leaner to a significant degree, where you can go, wow, more definition there, more definition here, significant degree from one training session. Well, I can tell from the things you say, from the things you do, and it's like your conscious mind is like just rushing around trying to do everything it thinks it needs to do.
Yeah.
When really your mind's not been set here, which is not a problem. You're going to work on that. That is the most important thing to work on.
Okay, I'll tell you what's been going on and see what you think. So, we've been doing these a four-day carb cycle, which consists of 3 days no carbs and then 1 day of carbs. And that's been absolutely fine. That's the good news. I've had no problems, been eating the protein, the fat, feeling fine, stable energy, no problems. I found there's a few conflicting beliefs inside my mind that are pulling both ways, because... I worry about if I'm not eating carbs, if I'm shrinking, or if I'm not getting enough calories, if I'm going to be losing muscle mass or something like that. So that's something that's been bothering me. But the good news is, on the carb days I've had, I haven't really enjoyed them. I didn't really like the sensation of eating the carbs, really. I sort of end up feeling bloated, and my energy is up and down and not as stable. It's like... it's not always cracked up to be really carbs.
Yeah, once your body gets used to ketosis and gets used to using body fat for fuel, which of course is its natural state, because we have to look in the body as an organism that we've inherited genetically over a period of thousands of years, if not hundreds of thousands of years. Okay, so. If we look about at the history of farming and the history of how we used to eat, never have we had the abundance of refined carbohydrates and the abundance of corn and refined carbohydrates that we have today. It's only a real sharp part, the last part of humankind, but we've had this massive increase in our, or change in our diet, where we've had a huge increase in carbohydrates. So that's why a lot of people, genetically speaking, will actually do well eating the kinds of foods that we've always eaten over the time period of human existence. And that's your natural foods, animal fat, nuts, fruits, berries, seeds, what was growing around you at the time. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Yeah, I really like that diet. It feels good, feels clean, you know, I don't feel bloated. I like that high protein, high fat. Yeah,
everybody, once as long as it's nutritious enough and you have certain things like chromium picolinate in your diet to make sure that your blood sugar levels stabilize and you get used to it, you give your body a chance. I mean, you've got used to it really quick, Ben. You've got used to it very quick, to be fair. Some people, when they start cutting carbs out, it takes them a few cycles before they actually get used to having no carbs.
Yeah. Well,
so if you're doing all right now, then this is going to, the next suggestion is to go to 4 days no carbs and a carb up day and see what your results are like that. And if you want to push it into 5 days, then do that.
Yeah, okay, well that's good then. I feel good about that, and I feel glad about that. And something that I think I've mentioned to you and Chloe, but I'll just say it for the benefit of our listeners. When I was doing like the no-carb days on my rest days, there was a couple of days I felt really bad, but I think it was because there weren't enough fats in the diet. I was having tuna and just salad, and there weren't enough substance in that to keep me going. But as soon as I started eating heavier meats and stuff and having avocado in there and oils and nuts and stuff, I found I felt fine with all that.
Yeah, when you eat low carb, it depends on how you've been eating, of course. But if you've been relying on a lot of carbohydrates in with your meals and with your food, and you cut the carbohydrates out, that's all people generally do is cut the carbohydrates out, so they're left with very little. So when you actually eat low carb, you generally have to up the protein. You have to up the quality fats, up the other nutrients, and you actually have to eat quite a lot of food. Sometimes you end up eating a lot more food, especially when you're after 2 or 3, 4 days of being on a low, on a zero carb or ketosis diet. Then you'll find that you can eat huge amounts of like meat and vegetables and stuff like that, and it doesn't even seem to bloat you out or fill you up as such. It doesn't make you feel stodgy. It just sits really well, and it gives you a constant energy across the day. It just fits really well, doesn't it, for most people?
Yeah, that's great. So I feel good about all that. I've adapted to that well. And the funny thing is, today I had a cheat day because I was due to do a cheat day, and I did it. And I've had ice cream and pizza stuff, and I feel like shit now. You know, I almost wish like I almost wish I didn't do it in a way.
Did you was you really craving
Not
your crap?
really,
Was it?
not really, not really craving. No, I'm more psychologically because I knew the day was coming and I was kind of looking forward to
Yeah.
having some cheap foods. But I
Yeah.
wouldn't say I was craving
Yeah.
carbs, really, not on a body level, no.
I mean, was you craving shit food? Was you craving like insulin spiking food? Was you craving?
I wouldn't say craving, not really, not strongly, no, maybe a bit, but.
If you're not craving the shit food, then you shouldn't be eating it,
Okay.
because it's only there to re-bring up leptin levels. Leptin levels drop when you lose body fat,
Yeah.
and when you lose body fat, leptin levels drop, which slows your metabolism down. But ghrelin levels go up, and ghrelin is the hormone that really makes you like, oh, I want pizza, I want chocolate. That's the hormone that really makes you ravenous for those types of
Really?
foods. Yeah.
Oh, I've
So
never heard of that one.
if you're not like, this is what I tell everybody. I think I'm sure I've told you this, but if you're not dreaming of like eating those types of foods, if you're not got a heightened sensory awareness to those types of foods, in other words, walking down the shop and you can smell the donut machine from the other end of the high street.
Yeah.
If you haven't got those strong cravings, you don't need a cheat.
Right. Yeah.
Okay? Because that's all a cheat is there for, is just to tell your body, don't worry, you're not starving. Look, we've got plenty of food. Bang, it
Yeah.
is.
Okay, so ghrelin,
Okay?
I've never heard of that one before.
Yeah, ghrelin. Sounds like gremlins, doesn't it?
Okay, so right, okay, so that's. So when that's dropping, that's when your body is literally craving. Is that because it's not getting. Why does it crave that then?
Why does it crave that type of food? Because the cheat foods or treat foods are always going to be really high in refined sugary carbohydrates. It's going to give you a lot of carbs, a lot of sugar. It's going to give you a big spike. Plus, they're very high in fat, so a lot of dense calories. So, in other words, a huge dense amount of food in a very short period serving lets your body know it's not starving. That's it.
I'll tell you something else I experienced, because I remember I've heard you talk about if you go for no carbs for several days and you might start to feel flat or something, and I've heard other
Yeah.
bodybuilders on YouTube say it as well, and then you have carbs and it sort of fills your muscles or replenishes them with glycogen. And I was kind of expecting to almost feel like I'd gotten bigger after my first carb day, which I didn't notice. I didn't feel any difference. I was kind of disappointed because I wanted to feel
Like
bigger,
a
you know?
yeah, you're talking about the rebound effect. So when you push your body in one direction, it will always try and go in the other direction. Just like we said about if you try and lose body fat, your metabolism will slow down. So you do things to kind of cheat what you're doing with your body.
Yeah, the
So
glycogen
when, when
replenishment.
yeah, so
Hold on
so
a minute.
your muscle is mainly made of water. It's 80, 90% water. It's a muscle. It's a cell. It's the largest cell in your body. So a muscle fiber is a muscle cell. So just like any other cell, to be to it works best, and it's at its performing its best when it's fully hydrated. What helps hydrate the muscle cell is glycogen. So coming from the carbohydrates you eat. So as you train and you pump and pump and pump and pump and pump, and you drain that muscle of its glycogen reserves, and it's not refilled because you're not having any carbohydrates coming in, that muscle will appear to shrink. okay, and it would appear to go flat. Now, bodybuilders, when they kind of like going through this type of training, they do very high volume training. So they're literally draining that muscle, pumping, 20, 30 sets on a body part,
right,
in a session. Just constantly pumping that muscle till it's completely drained. Yeah. So if you're not noticing after 3-4 days, we're going to jump to 4 days next carb cycling. We're going to assess you on that. You're training. I can't see how you're training. I know you're training okay, but as far as I'm aware, I would like to really up the volume of your training.
Okay.
So that you have a lot higher volume in your training. Okay. That will give you a nice volumization effect. Then if you drain your glycogen and have that kind of training, that kind of high volume, that kind of high intensity, that will drain your glycogen to a much larger degree. If you're just doing 10 sets, 15 sets, and you're just doing normal type training, it's going to drain your glycogen, but it's not really going to drain it right out and as drastically as it would as if you did high volume training.
I'm with you. Yeah, okay. So strength training, like just doing heavy, low sets, low volume, that won't drain as much glycogen.
Not as much. No.
Okay, so at this stage, we're kind of less concerned with strength training. We're more concerned with volume training at this stage, are we?
Yeah, you want to maintain if your goal is fat loss and you're natural, then you should keep a focus on maintaining your strength.
Yeah.
Okay, you want to make sure that your strength doesn't drop. Okay, or if it does, you're really making sure you're holding your strength. Mm. Okay. That's crucial, especially when your natural is a lot harder to maintain your strength when dieting. Mm. That's why the training sessions actually are harder, because it can be a lot harder to have the same training session on a diet than it can be normally. You can have exactly the same training session, but it'd be a lot harder, and you have to really push just to tell your body, yeah, we need this muscle. Yeah, I know we're eating less. Yeah, I know we haven't got any carbs, but we do need this muscle.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm with you. Okay.
Okay. So your strength should be maintained. But what you should be doing is looking at increasing the volume of your training. Just really upping the amount of sets you do. Just pumping the muscle. Just really pumping it a lot more.
Okay. All right. I can do that. I generally tend to start off like with a heavy right at the start, like 5 sets of 5 or something, and then I'll move on to like higher volume, higher rep stuff. That's okay to keep doing that then.
What we need to do is get you down and there's a particular formula for high volume training, because the problem with trainers you might have experienced is when you go heavy, you can literally burn out of strength. If you've burnt out of strength, there's nothing left in the engine to pump with.
Right.
Okay. It's like the engine's become weakened because you drain the strength, so you haven't got much left to pump with. So there's a bit of an art and a bit of a skill to making sure that you can go to a really high volume workout. If you use intensity at the wrong times, you'll burn out of strength, and you won't be in the volume of the workout will be a lot shorter than if you kind of used intensity at the right times, so you can just go on and on and on and on and on and on. And then at the end, when you're really done, like, bang, finish it all off.
Yeah, I know what you mean. So you can shoot yourself in the foot by sort of overloading yourself doing strength training, then you've got nothing left to sort of pump with. Yeah,
yeah.
I've experienced that. I've often wondered that before, actually, because you can, like, if you go higher reps and just go for the pump straight from the start, you can get, like, a better pump if you just focus on that.
Yeah, yeah. What you'll find is if you're going for the pump and you're going for the burn and that kind of training, unless you're going like ridiculously intense, you're not really going to burn out of strength. So what you'll find is the way a lot of bodies train is that they warm up the muscle, they pump the muscle, they do a lot of sets, and then kind of around about halfway through their workout or towards the end of the workout, they're going to have a rest for about 5 minutes, and then they do some real heavy strength training compound movements.
Yeah.
And this is it's almost like a natural way a lot of bodybuilders end up training, if you watch like the biggest guys and see how they train. Yeah. So it's like they're doing most of their workout is high volume, most of it's pumping, and then they just have that break and then put some strength training in the middle or towards the end.
I'm with you. Yeah, I follow that. I've got into the habit, like, I instinctively, you know, if I'm going heavy, I always have a lot much longer rest before I do it and go really intense kind of thing. Or if I'm trying to pump the muscle and get the burn, I'll have shorter rests and, I'll, you know, and do drops.
Yeah, there's a formula I've got. There's certain key things to kind of like bear in mind, like mainly how to use intensity, when to use intensity, the timing of your between sets and stuff like that. There's a formula which I can teach you for the rest of your workouts now, which will mean that your workouts will be a lot higher volume, which will mean that they maintain your strength, but will also mean that you'll get much better fat loss out of it, much more growth hormone out of it, much more testosterone. You'll get a much more physique changing effect from your workout in terms of like conditioning and losing body fat. So we need to get you down here probably Wednesday in 2 days time and do that kind of workout on you. We also need to increase your zero carbon because your body's fine. You can do it. You can handle it probably because you're healthy and you eat nutritious food anyway. So your body's adapted to it very quickly. So that's good news. So we need to up that to 4 or even 5 days before we do a carb up day. Okay. Your carb up day, ideally, we want to be putting that in on a rest day.
Okay.
Your body will, because you got to remember what's happening with carbohydrates when you eat them, they're being broken down, digested, blah, 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 into their single carbohydrate glucose molecules. The liver then has to convert that into glycogen to shut it off to the muscles. Okay, so it's not a case of you're going to eat this and it's going to go into your muscles like that. There's a whole process it has to go through, a biochemical process. Oh. And that doesn't happen like that. That takes time. So remember with your body, when it comes to rebuilding, healing, repairing, growing, the more relaxed you are, literally the more relaxed you are, the more efficiently those processes are going to happen. Of course, training is the opposite. Training, when you're training, you're pumped, you're psyched. You've put your body, it's not a good time to grow straight after when you've trained, because you're charged up, especially if you've got a busy day. Right. Your body's not in that relaxed, healing, growing mode, which is why we grow most when we sleep.
Right.
Because we're at ultimate relaxation. Okay, yeah. So that's why carbing up, you'll notice will be much more effective. Your body will like it much more when you're on having a rest day.
Okay, right, I see. So the liver has to do work, and so the body has to put its energy and its effort into processing the carbs. And if you're training, it's going to interrupt the carbing up kind of thing.
Mm.
Yeah, I see.
It's going to slow the process down because with your body you've got your automatic processes and you've got two sides to your nervous system. You literally got a go side and a stop side. Stop side is all the healing, repairing. The go side is all the adrenaline, strength, power, pumped up side. So the more you can exaggerate healing and repairing, and the more you can exaggerate that when you're training, the better results you're going to get.
I'm with you. Yeah. So if you're just overstimulated all the time, you haven't got both sides of the thing, and you won't get the optimal results. Yeah. I'm with you.
Which is very often you'll get a lot of people, and this is a lot of people experience this down the gym. If you talk to them, most people do at some point. They'll be on the training regime. They'll be going for it. They'll be really focused. They'll be really driven. They'll be really psyched, and they're training 4 or 5 days a week, and they're really hyped for it all. After 2 or 3 months, they get to a point and they're starting to feel really burnt out, and they either get ill, get cold, get run down, or they have to take a break for some reason, go on holidays. And then after they've had that week off, they come back and they go, I feel so much better. And I'm bigger.
Yeah.
I don't understand it. Yeah, because you've let your body fucking grow. You don't grow in the gym. You grow when you're chilled, man.
Right, yeah. It sounds so obvious when you say it, but there's not many people actually consider that, really, is there?
No, have a look, Ben, at the biggest guys you know, the biggest guys you'll see down the gym, or the biggest guys you know, you have a look at them when they're not training. They're generally, well, as far as I'm concerned, as far as I've noticed, they are like chilled.
Yeah.
Like a gorilla.
Yeah.
Like a lion.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then you look at the other, like, talking about animals, using that as an example, we look at the other animals that are on edge all the time and really nervous. They're not big built.
No.
The big animals are the ones, the powerful animals are the ones that are like chilled, conserving their energy.
Yeah, I'm with you.
Okay. Be a bear, lion. Be a bear, Ben.
All right.
Be a lion.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, so the two main things, the things we're going to tweak with what I'm doing then is I'm going to come down there, you're going to show me how to do better volume training, which is going to, at this stage, going to be the right. And the other thing I'm going to change is I'm going to do the 4 days or even 5 days if I feel like it. No carbs.
Yeah. Okay. Any carb up day is going to be a chilled out rest day, man.
Yeah. Well, that's good. It just so happens the 2 carb days that I've done since I was last down with you have been on rest days anyway, so that's good.
Probably why you felt tired, because on those days having the carbs as well is because your body's really trying to utilize them and kind of use them.
Yeah. Okay, that's good. I've had 2 rest days, actually. I felt like I needed 2 today, so my training split is 5 ways, but the cycle will be like 7, 8, 9 days, you know, before I come back round again kind of thing.
Yeah, that's cool. That's cool, man. That's about right. That's good. That's good. Cool. Have you got any other questions? Oh, you were concerned about like losing muscle when you're catabolism when low carbing and stuff?
Yeah. Is that a risk when you're low carbing, or is it okay as long as the protein and fat is high enough?
Depends on your body, on your genetic type, etc. I personally don't like to let my muscles go too flat.
Okay,
but because I'm very in tune and I have very high volume workouts, 2 or 3 days, I think last time I got ready for a show, I did 3 days zero carb, 1 day carb up. By the time I got to that 4th day, I was significantly leaner and absolutely gagging for some cheat food. So I'd start up my carb up day with cheat food, and then the next day I was waking up leaner again before going back to my zero carbs. But that's simply because the way I train, the how much I was draining the muscles, and I found that was about right for me. So what we're doing with you, we're finding out what works for you. Does that make sense? So you're going to get similar effects. I think up in your training is going to give you that effect that you're actually going to then notice, oh, my muscles have gone flat. Yeah, I can feel that.
Yeah, I haven't noticed that yet. Yeah.
But personally, I don't, being natural, I found that if you leave that flatness too long, it's almost hard for the body to bounce back and fill it up. That's what I've personally found. Not everybody's body is the same.
Yeah.
And certainly if you're on gear, it's a different story. Now you're probably going to find that you're going to be eating more protein on your low carb days, which is going to offset catabolism.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, have you noticed that? Have you looked at how much protein you're having on your zero carb days, roughly? Noticed you're eating more?
I'm eating quite a lot. I mean, you know, I've been aiming for the 200 grams of protein a day kind of thing, and I've certainly been eating plenty of volume of foods, you know, quite frequent meals. So I feel like I'm getting enough. You know, I feel like I'm never getting hungry. I'm constantly eating kind of thing.
It's a strange feeling, because like when you're zero carbon, it's not hungry you should be if you want to be burning fat, but there will be certainly that like an empty feeling, and you can actually almost feel when your body's burning fat for fuel.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
At the end of the day, you've got the basic idea that people kind of imagine it's all about, and that's calories in, calories out. Well, that has a relevance. If on your low carb days you're just constantly stuffing and stuffing and stuffing and stuffing your face, and you think that you just need to eat loads and loads of food, then at the end of the day you're still gonna not have much of a deficit going on. Does that make sense?
Yeah, right.
And so this is why feeling is coming in. You don't want to be stuffing yourself on any of these days. Yeah. You just want to be giving your body enough for what it feels like enough.
Okay, yeah, I see. I'm with you. I got a feeling I might have been guilty of probably eating too much towards the start when we started this project, but I think that's something I need to watch, actually.
Man, until you set a date, until you put some kind of deadline, so that something becomes like an obsession, because this is what this has become, and this is what it has to become. It has to become an obsession to go, right, how does my body really work? Well, I'm going to play about with this. I'm going to see how that feels. Play about this, see how that feels. Monitor the effects and see how that feels. Mm. This is why on that Robert Feasey interview, it took him, I think, 10, 20 shows before he got good at dieting. I'm not saying it's going to take you that long. You've got me to guide you. You've got lots of information and people to help you. Mm. But so you'll find a lot of bodybuilders, it takes a few shows before they get to know their own body.
Yeah.
So what you're doing, you're being completely obsessive like you should be, and you're really starting to tune into your own body and find out what works for you.
Yeah, okay then. It seems to me like I've got a tendency, like I seem to be really fine on the protein and the fat, and I almost don't really, I wasn't really craving the carbs. So, yeah, like we said, I think I can go a bit longer on no carbs. The other question I was going to ask, and people keep saying to me, even the vegetables have got some carbs in, like I'm eating avocados and stuff, and that's all right, is it?
It's negligible. The only vegetables you've got to really watch out for are the root vegetables, carrots, parsnips, swede, stuff like that. They're okay, but in high, you don't want them in really high quantities.
Yeah.
So greens, negligible. It's such small amounts. It doesn't really, it's not really going to impact it.
Okay. Okay. So the avocados are fine. I don't really have root vegetables. It's just mainly the avocados and the, you know. So that's okay.
So you just want to steer away from your potatoes, sweet potatoes, carrots, parsnips, all the root vegetables. Most of them are the ones going to be more carbohydrate. A small amount is going to be okay, a very small amount, but eat plenty of greens and stuff like that.
Yeah, that's okay. That's all right. Just to something we haven't really mentioned yet in this video, but so I've been getting leaner, but not really noticeably much leaner. And so I think it is important for me to step it up, you know, and do the things we just said, because I'm still still quite flabby, really, at this stage.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So, we need to really look at how you're training and your training next time we see you.
Yeah.
And go through all of that. And when it comes to aggressive cardio, have you been getting your aggressive cardio sessions in?
I have, but only one time a week. Does that need to be more?
That's probably going to be about right if it's highly intense. That's going to be fine.
Yeah, I've been doing it sort of, you know, like with the abs and the traps, and I throw in the ropes, you know, on that day.
Yeah. Now, what about your kind of like your mindset right now in terms of what you believe in terms of what's possible for your fat loss, what's possible for your physique? Do you have an image now that's becoming very clear of what your back looks like ripped, what your front looks like ripped, what your legs look like more defined? Do you have that image in your mind?
No, it's not as clear as it could be. And I was thinking about this the other day because you told me to do some visualization. I find it very hard seeing myself on stage. I find it very easy to visualize myself being ripped in day-to-day life. I can imagine myself how it would feel to be ripped and walk into in a room full of people, friends, day-to-day scenarios. But I find it virtually impossible to see myself being on the competition stage looking shredded.
Okay. Well, that's going to be... I mean, I'll give you a little example. You know the Body for Life challenge that Bill Phillips used to set in America, the 12-week body transformation challenge?
No, I've never heard of that.
Okay, in America, so it's a really big thing. A supplement company called EAS Sports, run by Bill Phillips. He used to run I think it was a biannual challenge out to the whole of America, who could go through the best physical transformation in 12 weeks with before and after photos using his method and his supplements, etc., blah, 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 blah. The winner gets a car and lots of money. Oh. So he had hundreds of thousands of people entering each year. And... the interesting thing is that the people that were the most successful, the people that won the challenge because they did the biggest transformation, every single one of them, from the very, very beginning, had a clear image of what they was going to look like, okay? They would also have, like, photographs, images of bodies or bodies very similar to how they wanted to look, and they would have those by their bedside, on their fridge, in their car, where they were constantly looking at it.
Mm.
So again, this is why I referred you back to the Arnold Schwarzenegger interview, talking about his shows, and he talks for about 10 minutes just drumming into people, look, I had a clear image, so clear, I could see my whole body, every body part, three-dimensional, zoom in, zoom out, the whole thing, and I could see myself on that day, on that stage, looking like that months ahead. Mm. And it's because his subconscious mind, which controls everything, was set. it was actually set so that almost magically that happened.
I'm with you.
So if you're at a stage now and you're like, I can't see myself on stage ripped, well then alarm bells should be ringing off, not to try and do anything, because that's the conscious mind. And the conscious mind so far for you has already tried to do everything it thinks it needs to do. But that's not where your mind gets set. That's not where the program is running. The program is running in the unconscious mind. And we create a belief. The easiest way for us to believe something is to visualize it. That's the language of the unconscious, is imagery. So if I was in your shoes right now, I wouldn't be worrying, I wouldn't be panicking, because that's the conscious mind. I would just be thinking, right, the most important thing for me to do right now is to reprogram my unconscious mind, not with words, not with logic, not with left brain stuff, but with the language of the unconscious, which is imagery and emotion.
Yeah.
So it may require you going into deep trance states like you've never been into before. If you've got any friends that are good at NLP and or hypnosis and this kind of thing, that certainly would make a good combination. But you really need to get that image, even if it just means getting some images of physique similar to yours, printing them off, cutting them out and putting them by your bedside and see how you start to change your belief over the next 2 or 3 days.
Yeah, I follow you.
But don't panic about it. Don't worry about it, because that's the conscious mind.
Yeah.
That thinks it's in control, and it's not.
Yeah.
Everything.
Generally pretty good with the visualization and all that kind of thing. I'm generally pretty good with that, and I think what's thwarted me is because I feel my fat loss has been like really slow, and I think that's sort of been undermining my belief about what I can achieve, kind of thing, you know. Because
you can't have blind belief, you know. You can't just go, I really, really believe that, so therefore it's going to happen. Because you have the personality, you have the character, you have to bring it into balance. You have to link the two, which is where meditation comes in, and all these kind of like techniques to kind of make sure that it's all working. But if the conscious mind is here, and the unconscious mind along here is not set, it's not programmed for the outcome, then the conscious mind will all day long think of things to do, try and do things, and it will rush around like a busy little bee, and all it's doing is just fulfilling the program, which is here.
Yeah, I'm with you. Yeah.
So if the conscious mind goes, oh, I'm not losing fat yet, I'm doing everything I think I can do, is there anything I've forgotten, and all that sort of stuff. And then, oh no, it's still not happening. It's because this hasn't been set.
Yeah, I'm with you, yeah.
And
yeah.
The interesting thing is, you look at other people who become successful at certain things, they go to their mentors, they go to their coaches, they go to these people. That's what gives them the belief, because then they go to bed and they go, and it's something that goes in, and they go, I really believe I can have this now. I really believe I can get it, because I've got the help. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? It's almost like mission slip.
Yes. Yeah. It's like listening to Mike Tyson, the way that old man completely sort of brainwashed him into believing he was going to be the champion, kind of thing. He totally. Yeah.
So he saw his potential. He believed in it. He could see his potential. He could see that possibility of that reality. All he had to do was make sure that Mike was programmed, and he literally programmed Mike.
Yeah, that's a good example, actually, those two, isn't it? Because he really did that. Like, Mike Tyson would have never done that without the old guy coaching him, would he?
No. I mean, you see, the thing is, you've got about 5 weeks left, is it?
Six, I think.
6 weeks. Weeks, man. For the amount of fat you've got to lose, you've got nothing to panic about.
Yeah.
But if I was in your shoes now, I would really get set on, you know, in the next couple of days, next time I see you, you need to be a different person in terms of how you're feeling about the whole thing. You need to have total belief, because you've got the knowledge, you've got the means. Your physique is at a level where you can do a show. You're competing with everybody else in the same boat.
Yeah.
No one else has won a show or done a show before, so you're going to be competing with complete novices, complete first timers. It's not a big thing that you're doing in terms of like you're going to be the best in the world at bodybuilding. No, you're competing at the low level, at a local show. It's not going to be. It's not hard. It's very attainable. It's very believable. It's very achievable.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Okay. All right. I'll work on that then.
Yeah. You're happy with that? Are you happy with what your mission is now? If it, at the very least, go get some pictures, go cut them out with physiques that look similar to yours. By now, you must have seen some fitness models that you kind of like look similar to that you might want to aspire to. Cut your head off of some pictures, stick it on there, do it on Photoshop, whatever. Just get those images, stick them by your bedside. So last thing at night, as you're unconscious mind is starting to open, that goes in. First thing in the morning is your unconscious mind is starting to close, that goes in.
Okay. I can do that.
I'd recommend doing some deep meditation trance work on visualizing yourself. If you can't do that on your own, then come down here Friday or something and we'll do that with you.
Okay.
But we really need to get your mind set and programmed. That if you can't see yourself clearly ripped on stage, if you're not seeing that, those images of you on stage ripped at this right now, 6 weeks out, that is the most important thing, because everything else will fall into place, Ben.
Yeah.
Everything else will fall into place. No good trying to intuitively guess how your body's feeling and whether you're losing body fat and all these things and trying to tune into that, if really deep down unconsciously the program that you're running is, I'm not going to be ripped in time. I'm not going to be lean enough, because that's all that the conscious mind is going to be filling.
Yeah.
But it doesn't realize it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Does that
make
sense?
It does make sense. Yeah. You're right. Okay. I need to work on that. I'll work on that.
Let me know how you get on. We'll get you down Wednesday for a training session. We're going to change the way you train as well. So that's going to make a big difference. I mean, I'll give you an example for myself. When I do a high volume training session, if I'm not having any carbs, man, the next day I am noticeably leaner. I'm visibly leaner to a significant degree where you can go, wow, more definition there, more definition here. Mm. Significant degree from one training session.
Okay. Yeah, I don't think I've experienced anything like that really yet.
I do have more of an advantage in that I have more muscle mass.
Yeah.
So I've got like a bigger engine to burn more fuel in the first place.
Yeah.
But I'm still convinced we can really up the volume of your training session.
Yeah. Okay. I'm looking forward to that because I believe that will make a difference, and I think that.
Yeah, of course it will.
That will. I think the more results I see, the easier it is going to be to wrap up my belief in it. You know.
Yeah. But at the moment, I mean, I'm going to be honest. I've kind of known where your beliefs have been. I've kind of known that you haven't really had full belief in your outcome.
Yeah.
Right? And what we've been seeing is you making like errors and mistakes, and it's like, why is Ben doing that? He knows that. Oh, he's doing that because he doesn't really believe in what he's doing.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean? I can tell from the things you say, from the things you do, and it's like your conscious mind is like just rushing around trying to do everything it thinks it needs to do, when really your mind's not been set here, which is not a problem. You know, work on that. That is the most important thing to work on.
Okay. All right. Okay. We'll work on that then. We'll fix that.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, that makes
sense. Remember, I'm on the end of the phone if you got any questions and you're stuck in the meantime, okay?
All right, okay, nice one then. So, all right, so I see you Wednesday then.
A bit of a telling off for Ben.
You're right, I agree.